This is John Daly with the Greek army of Alexander of Macedon in the Persian theater of operations. Here, near the Tigris River, we will soon know whether the war between Greece and Persia is to be ended by a negotiated peace. For the meeting that Emperor Darius of Persia asked for yesterday is about to take place. The emperor's ambassador, Prince Meniscus, has left the enemy lines 2 miles away, should arrive here shortly. And if Alexander accepts the terms he offers, this Greek invasion of Persia will be over. If Alexander rejects those terms, he must hurl his tiny Hellenic army against the overwhelming hosts of Persia in a final decisive battle for the mastery of Asia. The fate of Greece and the destiny of the imperial Persian government thus hang on the outcome of today's meeting here in the hills above the Tigris River.
This day, appropriate.
Darius of Persia offers peace to the invading Greeks under Alexander of Macedon. CBS takes you back more than 2,000 years to a great decision in the history of the world. All things are as they were then, except for one thing. When CBS is there,
you are there.
You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne, is based on authentic historical fact and quotation. Today's broadcast is part one of a trilogy. Alexander the Great seeks mastery of the world. And now,
Persia, the Greek Allied Expeditionary Forces, and John Daly.
Alexander will accept the peace offer of Emperor Darius, or he will engage the Persian monarch's huge army in a death struggle to decide whether Greece or Persia is to be mistress of Asia. 11 days ago, captured enemy scouts revealed that the main body of the Persian army was encamped here near the Tigris River. Alexander marched toward Darius, intending to force an immediate battle, but when the enormous Persian host was sighted 4 days ago, Alexander halted and hastily built a fortified camp. Yesterday, couriers arrived from Darius. They asked for a truce and an audience for Prince Meniscus, the emperor's ambassador. Though they said that Prince Meniscus would present peace terms, they gave no indication of what those terms may be. After consulting with his war council, Alexander agreed to hear the Persian ambassador. The meeting will take place under a huge pavilion erected here behind the Greek lines. Alexander's divisions are massed around the pavilion. The 10,000 men of the companion cavalry, the ranks of the phalanx, the archers, javelin throwers, and skirmishers of the auxiliary detachment. The king of Macedon is inside the pavilion, standing near the throne. The members of the war council are with him, and Alexander has graciously consented to a brief interview. Ned Kelmer is with the king of Macedon, so go ahead, Ned Kelmer.
The king of Macedon is in conversation with his counselors. He's promised to join us in just a moment. On this, perhaps the most important day of his life, the young monarch, only 25 years old, seems fresh and relaxed, utterly without care. A figure of a handsome youth with the finely developed body of an Olympic athlete. He's wearing a short linen tunic. His helmet is of polished steel with a white plume. His neck piece, also of polished steel, ornamented with precious stones, which Alexander has ended his conversation now, and he's coming this way. Your Majesty, by your leave, what peace terms do you think Prince Meniscus will offer on behalf of the Emperor Darius?
What terms will Darius offer? Why, the sun, the moon, and the stars.
Your Majesty is not serious.
Why not? The heavenly spheres are a fitting ransom for an emperor to pay for the return of his family.
Then you think the emperor is offering peace in order to get back his mother and daughter whom you captured 2 years ago?
That may be, but I also flatter myself that the great king wishes to make peace because he fears us.
If I remember correctly, sire, 2 years ago, Darius offered only a treaty of friendship in return for his mother and daughter.
You remember correctly. I rejected that offer.
Well, will you make peace with Darius now if he offers more than a treaty of friendship?
Perhaps. If he offers enough.
Well, how much is enough, sire?
Oh, the sun, the moon, and the stars.
Yes, I know, but seriously, Your Majesty...
Very well, then, if you insist on being serious... The Emperor Darius may have back his family and peace, too, if he will yield to me the throne of Asia.
That's a royal ransom.
Royal indeed. But to ask less would be an insult to the honor of the emperor's family.
But, sire, suppose the emperor is not prepared to bid that high for his family in peace. Will you accept less than the throne of Asia?
Let us not anticipate. Let us hear what Darius offers.
It amuses me to have the emperor of all Asia come begging to the king of Little Macedon.
It reminds me of a tale that was told to me when I was among the Israelites. As the tale goes, there was a giant named Goliath and a young lad named David. Now, these two...
Sire, if your majesty will forgive me, the Persian ambassador arrives.
Thank you. You must forgive me now. The sun, the moon, and the stars approach me.
Thank you, your majesty. As you heard, Prince Meniscus, the Persian ambassador, is arriving. So back to John Daly.
You are coming this way through the Greek lines. Prince Meniscus is riding in a gilded war chariot drawn by six black horses, gaily caparisoned. An escort of about 100 mounted Persian nobles rides with him, and they appear to be members of the great emperor's personal bodyguard, that famous group of warriors known as the Kinsmen. The Kinsmen wear heavy jeweled armor. Prince Meniscus, however, does not wear battle dress. He is clothed in a flowing golden robe. And now the Persians have halted near the pavilion. Prince Meniscus steps down from the chariot. His escort is dismounting and gathering around him. The prince is a tall man, well over 6 feet in height, has a look of arrogance as perhaps befits the representative of the ruler of most of the civilized world. He takes a large golden casket from one of the kinsmen and enters the pavilion. Alexander is seated on the throne. Prince Meniscus kneels before Alexander and sets down the golden casket on the floor of the pavilion, which is covered with rich purple carpet. The prince remains on his knees in accordance with Persian protocol, waiting for Alexander to bid him rise. Alexander speaks.
We bid you welcome, Alexander, King of the Macedons. I bring you a gift of jewels and gold from him upon whom the King of Heaven has bestowed the dominion of the earth, to whom the almighty Ahura Mazda has granted the surface of the four quarters, whom Providence has eminently distinguished with glory, exaltation, majesty, and with multitudes of devoted champions and confederates. The Emperor Darius, King of the Persians and the Medes, and ruler of all Asia. We thank your royal master for these tokens of his esteem. But in the list of impressive powers, titles, and honors that you attribute to him, you err in the last particular. Your master is not ruler of all Asia, not by half. I rule the lands west of the Tigris River, and will shortly rule the lands east of the Tigris as well.
That is in the hands of the gods, sire. In any case, my lord Darius does not fear to do battle against you. He has summoned his retainers from every corner of Asia. We have 200,000 horsemen on the plain below and 800,000 foot soldiers. 1,000,000 men, sire, and you have only 47,000. We outnumber you 20-1.
Ah, but you forget, Prince, I defeated a Persian army that was much superior numerically 2 years ago.
At Issus? I do not forget. Issus was merely an accident. It will not happen again. Even you, sire, must realize the utter madness of attempting to do battle with us now. If you choose to fight, we will scatter you as a thunderbolt scatters the creatures of the field. That remains to be seen. I warn you, sire, my emperor's patience has limits. Do not press him too far. By invading the lands of Darius, you have broken the 150 years of peace between Greece and Persia. I broke the peace. My royal father, Philip, was murdered by assassins hired by your master, Darius. I have come to revenge,
sire.
It's a convenient pretext to justify your invasion of Asia in search of loot and empire. I have heard it said that it was yourself who caused the murder of your father.
Liar!
I have the evidence to prove it was Darius who hired my father's murderers. Your emperor's own letters
arrogance in which he boasted of his deed. And not only my father, your emperor has attempted to murder me. We know of Darius's foul offer to pay 1,000 gold talents reward to the assassin who could succeed in killing me.
You may thank the gods, prince, that I value my honor more than your insolence. If we were not met here under a solemn oath of truce, I would have you flayed alive.
We are indeed grateful to your majesty's forbearance, but this is neither here nor there. We are not met to discuss the past, but the future.
Very well, then, the future.
Darius Tyre fears that your soldiers, made vengeful by defeat, would do harm to his family, which you hold captive. Therefore, the great emperor makes you this offer. Return the queen mother, Sidi Gambis, and the princess Tatira, and Darius will swear eternal peace and friendship with you. He will give you the hand of his daughter in marriage, and as dowry you shall receive 30,000 talents of gold, the value of a rich kingdom, and with it all the vast territories west of the Euphrates River. Accept, and you will become ruler of half of Asia, equal in stature to the Emperor Darius himself. Consider well, sire, this is the most magnanimous offer made by one monarch to another since time began.
Alexander is silent. His face is a mask. It's impossible to tell what his reactions are. He just gazes at Meniscus. Now Alexander rises and the king of Macedon speaks.
Your master's offer is worthy of our deliberation. I shall weigh it with my counsel.
Alexander has left the golden throne, motioning to his counselors to follow him. The king of Macedon is striding toward a nearby tent. He and his counselors will be in session there probably for some time. The young king does not necessarily have to follow their advice. Although he appeared visibly impressed by the offer, we have no way of knowing whether or not he will accept. One of the men who is probably best able to judge what is in Alexander's mind at this moment is Captain Hephaestion, commander of a Greek cavalry regiment and one of Alexander's most intimate friends. Don Hollenbeck is with Captain Hephaestion outside the pavilion among the cavalry, so go ahead, Don Hollenbeck.
Captain Hephaestion, do you think Alexander will accept this Persian offer?
Offer? The Persian has offered nothing.
Nothing? Do you consider half of Asia to be nothing?
Alexander already holds half of Asia by right of conquest.
Well, what about the hand of the emperor's daughter in marriage?
The princess Tatira is a captive. If Alexander wishes to wed her, what is there to stop him?
That's a good point, Captain, but what about those 30,000 talents of gold?
At Persepolis, the Persian capital, are 30 times 30,000 talents of gold, and it will all belong to Alexander when he defeats Darius on the battlefield.
Oh, you think you can win on the battlefield in view of the tremendous odds spelled out by Prince Meniscus?
Alexander has conquered Asia Minor. He has liberated Egypt. He has leveled the great high wall city of Tyre. The gods blessed his banners at Granicus and Ithus. The barbarians between the Tigris and the Euphrates were defeated. Everywhere the faint of heart thought victory impossible to achieve, and everywhere Alexander has been victorious. And he will be victorious again. He must conquer Darius, otherwise he betrays his destiny.
Destiny? What does Alexander consider to be his destiny?
Alexander claims to be a direct descendant of Heracles and Dionysius. His divinity was proclaimed by the oracles of Delphi and Zeus Ammon. And his destiny is proclaimed by these oracles. It's to conquer and rule the world as a god.
Do you believe Alexander's a god?
What I believe is of no consequence.
Well, if Alexander considers it his destiny as a god to conquer Asia, why is he even taking time to consider this Persian offer?
The king amuses himself. He pretends to be impressed by our Persian emperor. He is also courteous to his counselors, lending ear to their advice. But all the while, he is unshakably resolved upon the conquest of Persia. Mark my word, Alexander will shortly fling the Persian offer back into the teeth of Darius. There will be no peace today, but war.
Thank you, Captain Hephaestion. The young cavalry commander has given us one opinion as to how Alexander will decide. There is, however, another point of view, and for that opinion, we take you behind the Greek lines now to the village of Gaugamela. Ken Roberts speaking.
Here, in a large and magnificently appointed tent, are the living quarters of the Emperor Darius's mother and daughter, the elderly Queen Sisygambis, and the 18-year-old Princess Tityra. The gracious Persian queen mother and the beautiful princess have been traveling with this Greek army ever since they were taken prisoner at Issus 2 years ago. Alexander is a frequent visitor here, and he has supplied his royal captives with all the comforts of royalty. Your Majesty, Captain Hephaestion has just said that in his opinion, Alexander will definitely reject your son's offer of peace. May we have your comment on that?
I know he thanks you well. He has the mind of a robber. He did not receive any land from Alexander's conquest in the west. He wishes to receive land in the east. He hopes that Alexander will continue his campaign. Therefore, Hephaestion speaks his own mind, not the mind of the king of Macedon.
Well, Your Majesty, what do you think Alexander will do?
I'm an old woman. The young king has confided in me as he would to his mother. He has told me of his ambitions. In the beginning, he wished to spread the rule of Greece across Asia. But now, he has met and learned about our ancient, rich Persian civilization. He has learned to love our Eastern way of life. And he recognizes how crude and barbaric are the ways of the Greek.
Well, then, in your opinion, Your Majesty, Alexander has turned his back on his Greek ideals?
Let us say that he has outgrown them. Now he desires to create a blending of the East and West. He wishes Greece and Persia to be one. So, Alexander will make peace today with my son, and he will marry my granddaughter, the Princess Tityra.
Well, now my next question is rather a bold one, but I ask it because you've graciously consented to answer it. Is the princess agreeable to the match?
The Princess Tityra is the daughter of an emperor. She obeys her father's commands. Frankly, I think it will not be at all difficult to obey this command. The king of Macedon is a very handsome and charming man.
Thank you, Your Majesty, Queen Sisygambis. There's still no news from the conference tent where Alexander is discussing the Persian peace offer with his counselors. We have had some interesting reactions from persons close to the scene on what Alexander should or should not do. Just how accurately do these views reflect the desires of the Greek home front? For a report on that question, let's hear, after a brief pause, from Quincy Howe in our studios in Athens, Greece. Go ahead, Quincy Howe.
As far as I can make out, the Athenians want Alexander to turn down Darius's peace offer. They want Alexander to fight a battle. But when it comes to their reasons for wanting him to fight, the Athenians are split into two parties. The chief spokesmen of these parties are with me in our studios here. On my left is the director of the Lyceum School on the west side of Athens, near the Gardens of Apollo, the philosopher and scientist Aristotle. On my right is the outstanding civic leader in Athens today, former Lord of the Treasury, member of the City Council, General Demosthenes. I'm going to ask Demosthenes to speak first. Will you tell us, sir, why your party hopes that Alexander will reject the Persian peace offer and fight Darius?
Sir, Alexander is a tyrant who must be destroyed. And Persia is the only power on earth strong enough to destroy him.
Oh, rubbish. Well, General, that's a rather remarkable statement, especially from a Greek. Why, Demosthenes, do you object to Alexander? Why do you want him destroyed?
5 years ago, the city-states of Greece were free. We were at peace, flourishing.
then, hungry for power, this young upstart led his armies down from Macedon. Without provocation, he attacked our cities, tore down our walls, snuffed out our democracies, and forced us to submit to his tyranny.
Oh, no.
And not content with the domination of all Greece, he forced us to join his invasion of Persia, a war of conquest, of lust for blood and power. I say to you, there will be no end to his ambition, no end to our ruin, unless this madman is destroyed.
Thank you, General Demosthenes, for that strong, provocative statement of the case against Alexander. Now let's hear what the other side has to say. Aristotle, you're a friend of Alexander's. You know him intimately. As a matter of fact, sir, you were his teacher.
For 6 years.
Well, what about, then, this charge that Demosthenes has just made that Alexander has taken away Greek liberties?
Well, with all due respect for the eloquence of Demosthenes, I must point out that he is a professional orator, and professional orators are given to such phrases as tyranny, democracy.
Phrases? Those phrases are the soul of Hellas.
You will permit me, Demosthenes, since you are the noble champion of freedom, grant me my freedom to continue.
Very well, continue, continue.
Thank you. Now, sir, Demosthenes paints an appealing picture of Greek cities at peace with each other and flourishing before the advent of Alexander. But the fact, sir, is that before Alexander became king of Macedon, our cities were constantly at war with each other. Our wealth was expended on armies, fleets, attacks, counterattacks. Our economy was stagnating. The man of property was being taxed beyond his ability to pay, and the common citizen was pouring out his blood in fruitless warfare. Alexander changed all that. He has unified Greece.
Unity at the cost of liberty.
Without unity, there is no liberty.
That is specious.
Read logic, my dear sir.
Twisted logic, that's what it is. Twisted logic.
Indisputable logic. Gentlemen,
let it go. Why do you have to interrupt
one at a time?
Let's try to keep this discussion orderly. You've both given your views on Alexander's relations with Greece. Now, what about this Persian expedition? Demosthenes is charged that Alexander is waging a war of straight conquest. What do you say to that, Aristotle?
Well, having had the charge of Alexander's education, I believe I can speak with some authority on Alexander's ideas. His mission, as he sees it, is to spread the superior culture of Greece across all Asia.
But do you think, Aristotle, that culture, even a superior culture, can be spread at the point of a sword?
Alexander has already demonstrated that proposition.
Well, how so?
Well, as an example, take Egypt. 2 years ago, Alexander led his army to the delta of the Nile, and there he founded Alexandria. Its commerce is raising the standard of living of the inhabitants of the region.
Propaganda.
If you wish, you may call that spreading culture at the point of a sword, but it is culture nevertheless.
I had enough. No more. This is nothing but the mouthings of a paid propagandist in the employ of Alexander.
Are you accusing me of corruption?
I am.
How dare you? A vicious libel.
The king of Macedon has subsidized your scientific researches to the extent of several hundred gold talents.
But that is...
It is well known that he has scientists with his expedition who sent back specimens for your work on natural phenomena.
True. I'm grateful for Alexander's interest in science, but that does not make me a paid propagandist from Macedon.
Indeed.
On the contrary, it is you, Demosthenes, who are a paid agent of Persia.
I do not deny it. I have received gold from Darius to finance my struggle against Alexander. I make no secret of it. I am proud of it.
Proud? Betrayer of Greece?
Hireling of a tyrant?
Teacher of our ancient enemy?
Gentlemen, yes, here, just a minute. I'll have to interrupt this discussion. I've just been informed that Alexander's conference with his war council has ended. So we take you now, after a brief pause, to John Daly at the River Tigris in Persia. Go ahead, John Daly.
Here at the pavilion, we're waiting for Alexander. The conference ended a moment ago, but the king of Macedon has not yet appeared. His counselors, however, have come out, and Prince Meniscus, the Persian ambassador, and his escort are also here. General Parmenion, Alexander's chief of staff, is here with us now. General Parmenion, can you tell us what the king of Macedon has decided?
I cannot. I do not know what the king will do.
I don't understand. Didn't the conference reach a decision, sir?
The war council gave his majesty its thought on the matter. But the final decision rests with him. And he gave us no indication what that would be. Well, can you tell us what the War Council advised?
The Council advised His Majesty to accept the Persian offer.
Was the advice unanimous, sir?
It was.
Well, then, I should think that... Oh, excuse me, General. The trumpets are signaling the approach of the King of Macedon. He has left the tent and is walking toward the pavilion. His face impassive. There's no trace of a hint in his features as to whether he has decided on war or peace. It's a grim, frightening decision he must make. If he decides on peace, it means the end of years of hard campaigning. He and his soldiers will then return triumphantly to Greece with wealth and honor and glory. If he decides on war, however, it means a desperate battle against enormous odds. Alexander has now reached the throne in the center of the pavilion. He has seated himself, and now Alexander is speaking.
Let the Persian approach.
Prince Meniscus approaches the throne. At this decisive moment, he has lost none of his pride and his great dignity. With almost a defiant flourish of his golden robe,
rise.
He has knelt. Alexander bids him rise, and now the young
Sir,
king
your royal
is ready
master,
to address
Darius,
him.
Darius, desiring peace between Greece and Persia, has offered terms for settlement between our powers. But the gods, by giving success to my arms in conquering a great part of your master's empire, have manifested the justice of my cause. My answer, therefore, is this. If the Emperor Darius will have peace, he must acknowledge me as Lord of Asia and King of all his territories.
Impossible, sire! You ask the impossible!
Those are the terms! Deliver them to your Emperor!
Sire, I can tell you now. The Emperor Darius will yield no more than has already been offered.
So, you speak for your Emperor? Are you so empowered?
By his power and majesty, I am.
Then go and tell Darius that before another sun has set, he shall be stripped of his majesty and hurled from power. Go and tell your Emperor to prepare to defend himself. Today I conquer Asia. Tomorrow, the world!
Battle. Battle between Greece and Persia. Battle for all Asia. Incredible as it may seem, the young king has thrown away half of Asia is not enough. He has chosen to gamble for all of Asia. All or nothing. The trumpets are now signaling the end of the audience. The end of the peace conference. Prince Meniscus has stormed out of the peace conference in a rage. And Alexander, with his arms outflung, has turned to his own officers and his troops. Whatever reservations they may have had about the wisdom of battle against the million men of Persia seems to have been miraculously swept away. At least for the moment, they stand their pride and confidence on their face, ready to give battle. Prince Meniscus, as I said, has left the pavilion now.
You have been listening to The Peace Offer, another broadcast in the series You Are There, produced and directed by Robert Louis Cheyenne. The Peace Offer was written by Michael Sklar. It was part one of a trilogy, Alexander the Great Seeks Mastery of the World. Richard Waring played Alexander, Torrin Thatcher was Prince Meniscus, Bernard Lenro played Aristotle, Stutz Cotsworth was Demosthenes, Diveli Aliki was Queen Sisygambis, James Monks was Hephaestion, Charles Webster was Parmenion. Next week, part two of Alexander the Great Seeks Mastery of the World.
The battle for Asia. You are there.
Tonight on CBS, you'll find solid enjoyment and laughter on the Electric Theater as Miss Helen Hayes plays a backwoods wife who gets tired of drudgery and asks for a divorce. Hollywood star Eve Arden is also heard again as Our Miss Brooks, America's gayest schoolteacher. The Electric Theater and Our Miss Brooks are regular Sunday night features on most of these same CBS stations. This is CBS, Jack Benny's radio address, the Columbia Broadcasting System.